afternoon, Regeneration Nashville. Let's stand our feet. We get to worship Jesus today. We get to lift his name, not just any name. Let's let him know we're thankful for the only name, the beautiful name. Come on, let's let him hear our voice, our hands clap for you, Lord. The invincible name, the supreme name. We get to do that today. We want to welcome our lovely family online. Thank you for joining us. We love you. We bless you with that beautiful name, the beautiful name.
Amen. Well, Holy Spirit, I'm going to declare you are welcome in this place. Come on, Holy Spirit. Come on, Holy Spirit. Come on, let's talk to him. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. We invite, oh Lord, your presence. We invite you, Jesus, into this house and into our lives. We lift your name on high. We welcome. Can we just put our hands together and do that? Say, Lord, we welcome. Come on, like you mean it. Come on, like you mean it for the rest of your life. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Come.
Would you just lift your hands across the sanctuary? Say, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, we trust you. We trust you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your presence. Blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood, and what He did for me at Calvary is more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. trust you, trust you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We trust you. We trust you, Jesus. I saw the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I saw the a minute. Come on, I feel the Spirit of the Lord brooding. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your Spirit. Thank you for your anointing. Holy Ghost, work in the deep things. Work in the deep.
Thank you for your sweet presence here this afternoon, Father. Lord, you're worthy of it all, and Lord, you deserve it all. As you have a seat, tell the Lord, Lord, you're worthy of it all. Hallelujah. Before we do our declaration, I believe that we are supposed to give honor where honor is due. You guys agree with me? Well, yesterday, two of the finest people in the whole wide world celebrated their 37th wedding anniversary. And if you agree with me that they are two of the finest people in the whole wide world, would you join me and stand up and give them a huge hand clap and let our pastors know, Pastors Ken and Candy Christmas, how much they're loved. Sir, you mean the world to me. Candy, you mean the world to me. I love you guys so very much. You guys are special people. There's nobody like you guys. And I know you don't like this, but I've been at this church a long time and you have to forgive me. So there you have it. All right, guys, we're gonna jump right into our declaration. So you're already standing. So let's do it together. Ready? Here we go. Like we mean it now. Because I'm a tither and a giver, the windows of heaven are open to me, and God rebukes the devourer for my sake. I am blessed financially and receive a blessing that I cannot contain. I choose to sow cheerfully and bountifully, knowing I will reap bountifully. He makes me the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. The blessings of God are chasing me and overtaking me because God loves to see me prosper. I am believing Him for advancements, God ideas, blessings, and increases. Financial freedoms and breakthroughs. Amen. Ushers, you can serve the people. Be blessed.
Thank you so much. Hey, has anybody told you they love you yet today? Oh, I love you. I'm so glad to have you here today at Regeneration Nashville. Oh my goodness, where's Jasmine? Come here, Jasmine. Stand. Is that the right key for me? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jasmine. Happy birthday. Look at that. Thank you. Your love touches my heart. It really does. Jasmine, Pastor Kent and I were married August 17th, 87. And she was born August 17th, 88. And so never again did we ever get to celebrate an anniversary. Next time I think that's a clever idea, remind me not to have a baby on my anniversary. So, but anyway, I do want to say happy anniversary to my husband. I love to embarrass him, so I'm just going to go on and say it. I was 28 before we married, and so I had been praying a long time for a husband. And a prophet came up to me one time. This is true. And he said, the Lord spoke to me about your husband. I was praying, fasting and praying. And I said, really, what did he say? And the Lord said, well, you've never met him before, but he's got pretty feet. Beautiful are the feet upon the mountain. So that meant he was going to be a preacher. So when I met Pastor Kent, he was homeless and broke and sleeping in his car. And I said, take off your shoes. If you got pretty feet, you're in. So anyway, he has pretty feet, and I love you and I honor you. And so it's been 37 wonderful, glorious years, and I honor you for that. I honor you. One time I heard a marriage, a pastor preaching on marriage, and he said, a good marriage is made of two forgivers. Right? So, anyway, not that you need forgiven. I need forgiven. I don't know. I've dug a hole. I'm just here. So, anyway, okay. So we have, let's change the subject. Let's move on. Anyway, happy anniversary. So we have visitors from Illinois. Where is Illinois? Stan, God bless you. Huh? The great state of Illinois. You seem happy about it. What if we make a Tennessean out of you? Don't you love them? Can we keep you? They're preaching, folks. This is wonderful. I love you so much. They sing Southern God. Are you twins? Oh, they're twins. 12, she's 12 minutes older than her. My goodness, I'd love to hear y'all sing sometime. They will be 60 tomorrow. Isn't that great? Oh, God bless you. I can't wait to squeeze you and hug your neck. I love you. I love you too. Thank you. Give them a good hand. Thank you. And one of my favorite states, Minnesota. Please stand and let us welcome you. These people are wonderful. I've waited my whole life to meet you, and I'm glad you're here. God bless you. Thank you for coming from Minnesota. And Rhode Island, we have Rhode Island. Stand, Rhode Island. Thank you so much. Which of you is Chrissy? This is Chrissy. Okay, she emailed and let me know she was coming. I'm honored that you're here, all of you. God bless you. Thank you for being here. Do we have anybody, any other state that we can recognize while we're here? Anybody else from out of state? No. Okay. Sorry? Virginia. All right. Praise the Lord. Honored to have you. God bless you. Glad that you are here. So next Sunday, we have our Renew class, and that is the foundational teachings of our church. If you would like to be a member of Regeneration Nashville, we would love for you to come. We have a wonderful time in that Renew class from 1:30 to 2:30 in the choir room. And Pastor Harry Saylor and I will be teaching that class. And it's important for you to know. It's very important for you to know what your church body believes. And so the Bible says, how can two walk together unless they agree. So it's very important that we walk in unity together. The Bible says to know them that labor among you. So come to the Renew class and become a member, and that way you can serve in all areas of ministry here in Regeneration Nashville. Also, if you've never been water baptized, it's very important for you to be water baptized as a believer. And so our baptismal service will be next Sunday. So go online at regenerationnashville.org and sign up, and we will get you water baptized. So please come and do that. So I've got something really fun I want to tell you. I think this is wonderful. So I don't want to use the word choir, because I think we had the most wonderful choir and the greatest choir director that a church could ever ask for. Where is Steve Malden? Stand up, Steve Malden. He don't like me embarrassing him. And so the choir has paused for a moment. Steve Malden is one of the busiest and most revered musicians in this city, has many Grammy Awards to his credit. So the choir has taken a pause, but we have started a praise collective. And so that is kind of a singing ensemble. And so there's no tryouts. So even if you just come and make a joyful noise unto the Lord, that's okay. No tryouts, you're in. Right now, I'm just telling you, you're in. And the rehearsal time, you will rehearse with the praise team from 1:30 to 2:30, and church starts at 3. And then your first Sunday to sing, it's called the Praise Collective, will be the first Sunday in September. So doesn't that sound exciting? I miss our singers over there, don't you? Isn't that wonderful? So to sign up, go to regenerationnashville.org. Let us know that you would like to be in the Praise Collective. And we're just excited about that. So I love you so much. I'm going to ask Pastor Kent to come. I think it would be fitting. Why don't you just stand and give Jesus Christ the greatest hand clap of the day. Come on, somebody. Just give it up for Jesus. God is good all the time. He's good all the time. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Why don't you, so you don't have to get back up, just remain standing, grab your Bibles, your iPhones, and we're going to read out of Ephesians chapter 6. And Thursday, I'll read this and then I'll let you sit down, I'll talk to you. Ephesians chapter 6 is one of my favorite chapters in the entire Bible. It's so full of powerful direction for God's people. But I want to just read one verse out of Ephesians 6, verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. You may be seated. I was going to prayer, and I still had gotten no direction from the Lord for today, and it was Thursday morning, and I thought, Lord, you know, I need something. I just can't go out, stand up there and tell everybody I don't have anything. And but I refuse to just give you a canned message. And so I always trust that the Lord will drop something in my spirit. And in prayer, God began to put this in my spirit. And I think it's going to help you today. How many feel like that the last several months have been an attack of the enemy? Not only personally for all of us, but corporately in the church, and also nationally. Our nation is under great attack right now. And there is this onslaught of the enemy. And the writer here begins to speak, and he said, you are going to wrestle. And there are different words for this. You're going to fight. You're going to be engaged in a battle. But he said, you need to understand that the battle as a child of God that you are in is not people. And that is a deception of the enemy when we feel like that it is a person that we need to battle. I can tell you this, you will never win it. You will complicate it. You will alienate people in your life. You will make people choose sides, because the things that bring division in our lives and in the church and in the nation are demonic. And as human beings, we obviously have to navigate relationships, and that takes the wisdom of God. But the sixth chapter of the book of Ephesians is not dealing with natural people. It's dealing with natural or supernatural spiritual enemies. And this is why Paul begins to finish this chapter about weapons. And there's a verse that says this, the weapons of our warfare are not natural weapons. And this is one of the unfortunate mistakes that the body of Christ has made, is that we are at times trying to fight demonic entities with natural weapons. You will make no difference whatsoever picketing in an abortion clinic. You're wasting your time and you're wasting your breath. Protesting things makes no difference, because it's not people, it's the spirit behind them. And so the Lord begins to tell us, he said, you are going to be engaged in a battle, in a wrestling match, in an entanglement with not natural things. He said, what you're going to be engaged with are principalities, powers, and rulers. In fact, the word rulers there, one of its meanings in the Greek literally means Satan. So he's telling us, he said, there are going to be seasons of wrestling with a spiritual enemy that wants to destroy you. But we also know that there are times in our life where we wrestle, but not with the enemy, but we wrestle with God. How many can say, I've had to wrestle with God? God's will and your will. Or God telling you, this is the direction I want you to go, and you don't want to move, you don't want to change jobs, you don't want to do something, but you're wrestling with God. And so we know that the outcome of wrestling with God always makes you better. It's not a match to death. It's not a match where God wants to wound you. His intention is not to destroy you or to kill you, but it's to make you better. The beautiful example of this is in Genesis, where it says of Jacob, that Jacob at the He's spent 20 years since he's been home, and he is a supplanter, and he's a cheater, and he's a conniver. Yet what makes him special, at birth, there is a prophetic declaration over his life that says he's going to do something that's going to advance the kingdom of God. But he could not fulfill his purpose without the wrestling match. When you read of Abraham, the Bible says that all Abraham got was the promise. A little later on, when you read about Isaac, it says he got the covenant. But the wrestling match changed Jacob's name and gave him a nation. Yes, sir. Hallelujah. I'd rather have a nation than a promise. But through that process. And so that is just part of the journey of being a believer. But it's really not what I want to focus on today. I felt like the Lord dropped this in my spirit on what we are dealing with, not only for this church personally, but I can tell you right now that you and I are wrestling with the devil. We are wrestling with the enemy. And if you read out of Acts chapter 16, because this is really the only place in the scripture that deals with this particular name, and it is a python spirit. And when you read Acts 16, the Bible says that there is a young girl that is harassing Paul, and the Bible says she does this for many days. There are sometimes the enemy, when he wants to kill you, draws it out. It's not a swift blow. That's why I think it's in Daniel, it talks about he comes to wear out the saints. It's every day a little bit more virtue comes out of you and a little more strength is depleted out of you until one day you encounter something and you no longer have the strength to deal with it, to navigate it. And so after many days, the Bible says that Paul just looked at her and he said, I command you to come out of her. And the Bible says, and he came out of her. And so the origin of the Greek word pythona comes from the Greek mythology, where Apollo, the Greek god, slays a serpent in the region of Pythro, who guarded the oracle of Delphi. And the residents of Philippi believed that the slave girl got her powers to operate in the supernatural realm from the spirit of Python that was associated with this mythological serpent. Isn't it interesting how many unbelievers believe in the spirit realm? Yeah. Right. Weird stuff. But when it comes to the balance of Christianity, they shun it, denigrate it, cast aspersions against it. And so when I began to do this study, there is a spirit, I believe, that is loose in the earth today. And what you and I are wrestling with is a serpent spirit, a python spirit that wants to destroy you. And a python lurks. It hides itself until its prey comes by and it strikes it, stuns it, and then begins to wrap itself around this prey. In the world today, especially in some of the eastern countries where they are indigenous to that area, pythons have been known to grow up to 25 and 26 feet and weigh well over 200 pounds, and they are nothing but muscle. Yeah. They don't kill instantly. They just stun their prey until they can begin to wrap around it and wrap around it and wrap around it with its muscle, and then it begins to constrict. It begins to crush the individual until it suffocates. And then not only that, after it kills it, it will detach its lower jaw from the skull, elongate its mouth, and begin to swallow its victim. And there is a spirit loose in the earth right now that is beginning to squeeze the righteous and the God-fearing people of the land. And I can tell you that God has given us a solution to defeat the powers of this. And when you think about it, this is historically in the Bible, tracks all the way back to the Garden of Eden. The very first battle that man ever had in his life was with a snake. Nothing else. It was with a snake. And the Bible talks about it. He said there was deception that was involved. That Eve didn't realize that the moment she begins to converse with this serpent. I find it interesting that the scripture says that Satan entered into the serpent. He picks the most articulate, the most handsome of all. It didn't look like a snake looks now. He was enticing. He was beautiful. He was smart. In fact, the Bible said the serpent was more subtle than any of the beasts of the field, which means to be shrewd and cunning. And while Eve is talking to the serpent, she doesn't realize that that thing is intertwining her. It is circling her. And what it is after is the prophetic purpose of God on her life. And there are many of you today that you think, what am I going through? Why is this so hard? It's because the enemy wants to snuff out the divine purpose of God in your life, to wear you down until you finally say, I cannot take it anymore. But weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. I declare to you, I don't care what hell has to throw at God's people. When the dust settles, the Bible says she will be a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. And the enemy cannot circumvent us, cannot stop us, cannot kill us. But we are blood-bought by the power of the Lord, and the hand of God is upon us, and we will prevail. The first thing that God ever gave man in the Garden of Eden was the breath of life. And this is why, this is how the python operates. It doesn't kill you with venom. It begins to constrict you. And I hate snakes, and so when I was researching this, they would show pictures, and I would just kind of look to the side. I would look down on the righty, because I thought, I'm going to bed in 2 hours, and I don't want to dream about snakes, because the only nightmares I ever have are about snakes. And when I was reading, I said this. It said, a python spirit, when it begins to wrap itself around its prey, it begins to slowly constrict. And what's happening is it begins to reduce the blood flow in the prey. And the breath comes from this, because life is in the blood. And in the blood is what carries the oxygen, which allows you to breathe. And so when the serpent in the Garden of Eden was entwining Eve,
He didn't want to just kill her. He wanted to take from her what God had given her, because God had breathed into her the ruah, the very breath of God. So what she had in her was the life of God. And so there is this constricting demonic spirit that is trying to intertwine the power of the Bible and of the word of the Lord, and slowly constricts month after month and day after day and week after week. You think, God, is it going to get any better? What you don't realize is that the enemy is trying to kill you and take out of you the breath of life. And that's why you have to resist the devil, submit yourself unto God, and let him flee from you. And so I was, as I was praying and thinking on this, my mind went back to, in fact, you could turn with me there, but it goes back to the book of Exodus, chapter 4, because this has always been a little bit confusing to me on why God would do this particular thing. In verse 1 of 4, Moses says, "Behold, they will not believe me, nor hearken unto my voice. They will say, the Lord hath not appeared unto thee. And the Lord said unto him," speaking of Moses, "what is in thy hand? And he said, a rod. He said, cast it on the ground. And he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from it." And so the next verse says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, put forth thy hand, take it by the tail. And he put forth his hand, and he caught it, and it became a rod in his hand." So when I was praying, I felt like the Holy Spirit began to speak this to me. Moses was getting ready to encounter a python spirit in Egypt, because the Bible says that the people of God have now been in slavery and everything is being squeezed out of them, their liberties, their wealth, their health, their freedoms, until they are being reduced to just human beings that hardly have any semblance of life. And the scripture says that they begin to cry to God for deliverance. So God goes to Moses, and of the first thing that he does is he says, "Throw down your rod," and it becomes a snake. Moses understood snakes because he lived in the desert. And immediately the fear hits him and he begins to back up. And God said, I need you to get a revelation of something, that when you have the hand of God on you, you have the power over a serpent. He said, reach down there and get a hold of that snake and pick it up. And Moses, I wish we had a video of it, but he's probably doing this. And he just kind of reaching down, and that snake's laying there, and he gets a hold of it, and it turns back into a rod. And God said, I want you to know something, son. You got authority over a snake that it looks like it's going to bite you. But God said, when there is an edit from heaven that says, get a hold of it, you have the authority of God. I declare in the name of the Lord, I don't care what kind of snake has crawled up on you, crawled up on our nation, crawled up on your health. God says, reach down, get a hold of that thing by the power of God. And you just go a little bit farther over to Exodus chapter 7. Verse 1, Lord says unto Moses, see, I've made thee a God to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. Verse 8, And the Lord spake unto Moses and to Aaron, saying, when Pharaoh shall speak unto you, saying, show a miracle for you, then you shall say unto Aaron, take thy rod and cast it before Pharaoh, and it shall become a serpent. Now, Aaron has not had this encounter. So, probably when Moses told Aaron, once you throw down your rod, it's going to become a serpent, Aaron said, no, we don't want to do that. But Moses says, no, I'm telling you, I've seen what God can do. And he said, they want a sign. We're going to give them a sign because one of the gods of Egypt was a snake. And so, verse 10, Moses and Aaron go unto Pharaoh, and they did so as the Lord had commanded. And Aaron cast down his rod before Pharaoh and before his servants, and it becomes a serpent. Then Pharaoh also called the wise men, the sorcerers, and the magicians of Egypt, and they also did in like manner with their enchantments. This goes back. This is why it's a python spirit. It's because in Acts it's dealing with the spirit of divination. And in here, the scripture says that what Moses is dealing with is the spiritual leadership are magicians, sorcerers, oracles of the enemy, and they have great power. So the scripture says that God tells Moses, throw down your rod and it becomes a serpent. And the same thing happened with these magicians. Their rods became serpents. Verse 12, for they cast down every man his rod, and they became serpents. But Aaron's rod swallowed up their rods. So here's the setting. God has already did this work in Moses. He said, you, the only way you're going to loose my people is to lose your fear of a snake. This is why it's inherent in human beings. I imagine I couldn't get five people to stand up in this congregation today to say, I like snakes. Most of us don't like them. They terrify us. They have a look to them. And Moses, God saying, I need you to set this nation free, but you cannot do it until you are not intimidated by a python spirit that's wrapped itself around my people. And I declare the name of the Lord. There is a political python that has wrapped itself around this nation and is sucking the liberty and the life, the morality, the godliness, the holiness and the spirit of the Lord slowly out of it. But God is raising up some Moseses in this hour. Hallelujah. And have met the enemy in the midnight hour. And have said, me and you have had a face-to-face tit-tot. And I have authority over you in the name of the Lord. As a man of God, I take authority today over every snake in this building, over every serpent in this nation. And I bind you in the name of Jesus, and we loose the word of the Lord in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I tell you by the Spirit of the Lord, the rod of God is getting ready to swallow up the rod of the enemy in this nation, and the python spirit is going to be defeated. So 1 Peter chapter 2, and we talked about this recently. Of course, the writer here, he understands what he's saying because the Lord, when he made the declaration at Caesarea Philippi, upon this rock will I build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. He looked at Peter, he said, you are a little stone. But he did call him a rock. Said, you're just not the main rock. So when Peter begins to write here in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5, he speaks of you and I. He said, you are living stones. that really, I mean, that's a wonderful verse. It's a wonderful comparison. But when you link it with Proverbs chapter 30, verse 19, it takes on a different meaning. Because when the writer's writing in Proverbs, he said, there are things that are too wonderful for me. He said, but I can tell you one of them is this, the way of a serpent on a rock. And what he was saying was, when you're a rock, you go back down south, you can go to the swamps of South Carolina where my dad was raised, you can go to Louisiana, and you can paddle back through the bayous there, and you can look up on the bank, and you can see a big old cottonmouth or some of those snakes curled up on a rock because the sun's heated up the rock during the day. And they're laying up there like kings. But when the sun goes down and the rock cools off, the snake crawls off. And when you go look at the rock, there's no mark on it. Didn't matter how long the snake laid up there, he cannot leave a mark on a rock. And when God told us that you and I are living stones, and the writer said, there's something wonderful about the way of a serpent on a rock, that I can tell you by the Spirit that some of you have a snake that has crawled up on you. Some of you have a serpent that has wrapped itself around you. But there's something wonderful, hallelujah, when you are a rock, that when the serpent has to get off, and he does have to get off, there is no mark on you, that when the enemy, hallelujah, comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord raises up a standard against it. And I hear God saying, I've just about had enough of hearing my people cry unto me for deliverance, and I'm getting ready to loose a Moses anointing of some men and women that have been to hell and back, and that learned how to deal with a serpent, that when the breath of God is trying to be crushed out of you, you shake yourself and you begin to declare, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You say, but Pastor, how do we know that we're going to recover? Mark 16 and 18 said this, and it's been taken out of context, but it says, these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall take up serpents. And of course, it's been taken literal by some really good people, and many of them have died from snake bite or drinking some deadly thing with strychnine. But I believe that verse was put in the Bible not for a natural interpretation, but for a spiritual application. These signs, hallelujah, shall follow them that believe. They not will, or they not maybe, or sometimes, but they shall. Hallelujah. When the writer was being inspired by the Holy Ghost, maybe the Holy Ghost was remembering the day that Moses reached down and picked up a snake that used to be his rod of authority. What God was saying, son, this is your authority. And when the enemy looks like he's circumvented, pick it back up, because it'll be authority in your hand by the power of God. Whatever you bind, I'll bind. Whatever you loose, out loose. May God loose a fresh wind of authority in this building. They shall take up serpent. I'm getting a hold of the snake today, and I'm binding this python spirit that has been loosed in the earth. Amen. So this, if you know anything about snakes, they don't die easy. I've seen snakes before on the road, and I've run over them on purpose. Look in my mirror, and there ain't nothing wrong with them. Put it in reverse, back up. You can feel it, bum, 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 bum. Their body is resilient. There's some kind of rubbery constitution to them that it enables to handle the pressure. The only way you can really kill a snake is you got to cut its head off. See, we've been driving over it. We can't figure out why next week we're still fighting the same snake. Because this is why in Ephesians, right after he says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we're wrestling against principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spirits of wickedness in high places, this python spirit that just keeps squeezing. How many of you feel like you've been in a vice grip? It's every single day, every single moment. It just feels like it just gets tighter and tighter and tighter. And you think you're binding the devil and you're rebuking him. And you're saying, God, won't you do something? And God's saying, why don't you cut off the head? And you say, Lord, how do I do it? And take unto you the word of God, which is what? The sword of the Spirit. Hallelujah. God put that in there. And he's telling you that when it looks like the enemy is sucking the life out of you and crushing the breath of God out of you, get a hold of the word of the Lord. No weapon shall be formed against me shall prosper. Every word that rises up in judgment against me, we shall condemn. We curse every demonic serpent in the name of the Lord. We break it off the United States of America. We break it off of the church. We break it off of Regeneration Nashville. We break it off of 709 Rivergate Parkway. According to the word of the Lord, if you're a student of the scriptures, everything that was lost in the Garden of Eden, God at some point goes back after it. Doesn't matter what it is, there is a restoration of that. And with that constricting spirit. See, the enemy doesn't just want to kill you and I and kill this church. Then he wants to swallow it. Because the acid in its stomach begins to dissolve the prey that's in there. Until eventually, it's as if it never existed. So resurrection from the dead doesn't really matter because there's nothing to resurrect. And so the longer that thing has a hold of you, the closer it is to swallowing you up. And only God can turn this thing around. And I tell you what, there's a boldness. I feel a boldness today in the name of the Lord. But I am tired of being intimidated by liberal voices that keep saying, if you're not politically correct, we're going to jerk this and shut that down and get you off of that. Go for it. Hallelujah. Because the Spirit of the Lord is going to loose the Word of God. Before there was ever YouTube and Facebook, in the book of Acts, hallelujah. And when this was noised abroad, the Spirit of the Lord drew them to us. A few years ago, without advertisement, without TV, we went from 100 to 600 people in 5 weeks with just the God, hallelujah, doing it by the Spirit of the Lord. We will not bow down. We will not give in. We will not yield to an intimidating python spirit that is trying to crush us. But by the Spirit of the Lord, hallelujah, we declare by the Word of God that we shake this thing off, that there's something wonderful about the way of a serpent on a rock. I loosen you. I loosen you today. God, put a shout in your spirit to declare that we are not going to die. Hallelujah. The issue that we're dealing with now is that by the time we get to the end of the age, which we're at, in Revelation chapter 20, the serpent has increased exponentially. Till the scriptures call it a dragon, it just means a large serpent. How did it get to be big like that? It's ate a lot of people. It's got a lot of preachers in it. Got a lot of churches that it swallowed. Got a lot of godly psalmists and songwriters that somewhere the enemy got a hold of them and wrapped itself around them until today. The Bible says that it's a great serpent. But God saw this day, because there is a reason why Jesus is called not the second Adam, but the last Adam. There could only be two. If he's the second Adam, then there could have been a third, and there could have been a fourth. And he was not going to be the third. He was the last Adam. So as the last Adam, Jesus' purpose in the earth is to come back and to recover everything that was given to man at creation. The serpent could be in the garden, but he had no authority. He couldn't do anything. You could walk by him and he could just have to sit there and watch you because he had no rights. And it is in the garden that he constricts Adam and Eve, sucks the breath of God out of them, the ruah of God, until they are no longer viable for the eternal purpose of the Lord. And now, several thousand years, 4,000 years later, a last Adam, hallelujah, comes out of the womb of a virgin girl named Jesus. And at the terminus of his ministry, when he sees the shadow of the cross, the Bible says that Jesus goes back to the garden. He could have went a lot of places. But see, this thing started in a garden and it has to end in a garden. But I love the fact that the reason that he went back to that garden, because that garden was also the familiar place of prayer. Yep. Hallelujah. And this is why in Ephesians chapter 6, talks about putting on the armor of God, and above all, taking the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And then it lists the last one and it says, and praying always. praying always, hallelujah. A prayerless church will be sucked to death by the enemy. A prayerless Christian will wind up being constricted by a python spirit. And every bit of purpose that God has in your life will be destroyed by the enemy. But when you got praying men and women, when Peter was locked up in prison, the Bible said the church in the nighttime began to pray and suddenly, hallelujah, the place was shaken by the Spirit of the Lord. And this time, I believe that Jesus in the garden, in prayer, encounters this python spirit, and he begins to wrestle because he's without sin. He's not wrestling over, Father, do I want to give you my life? He is wrestling because the enemy, it's interesting that in Genesis, the enemy is saying, eat the fruit. And in the Garden of Gethsemane, he's saying, don't drink the cup. And Jesus begins to wrestle with this thing. And this thing is trying to constrict him. In fact, the Bible says that angels have to come and begin to strengthen Jesus. This was not a battle between him and his Father. Or angels would have not had to come and strengthen him. He was in a demonic fight with a python spirit that was trying to suck the breath, the ruah of God out of him until finally he says, Father, not my will, but thy will be done. And Jesus rose up that day having defeated. What did he do? He recovered. He recovered the ruah of God. The reason the enemy is constricting us, he's trying to get out of us the Spirit of the Lord. 50 days after resurrection, a new creation takes place in an upper room. Suddenly, hallelujah, there comes a sound from heaven like a rushing mighty wind. What is going on? The last Adam went back and defeated that constricting spirit, got a hold of the wind of God, and on the 50th day, Pentecost, said, I'm putting back in the earth, hallelujah, the very nature of the Lord. And it filled all the house where they were sitting, and they began to speak with new tongue. I speak today that there be a fresh wind begin to blow in this building, that no longer are you depressed, are you discouraged, are you pressed out of measure, but there be joy today, that good reports begin to happen, that the enemy is destroyed, that we are cutting off the head of the serpent today in the name of the Lord Jesus. I end with this. Satan is obviously the head of this demonic thing. And this is a battle that was between him and Christ, because the scripture says that Jesus Christ is the head of the body. The church. Well, Jesus made this statement. He said, I am he who was dead, but I am alive forevermore. Yep. What he was saying was, you ain't cutting off my head. This body ain't dying. Hallelujah. You're not cutting the head of the church off. See, that's what's right now. That's what's happening in our nation, is the enemy is trying to cut the head of the church off. But there's too many of us, hallelujah, by the power of the Holy Ghost, that are digging in our feet and saying, not today. Hallelujah. You may have done this 40 years ago. You may have done it 100 years ago. But today, hallelujah, there is some prophetic scriptures that need to be fulfilled. That in the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And I decree in the name of the Lord, these dog days, these dark days, these days of light, these days of despair, these days of heaviness, we cut the head of the serpent off. It's time, hallelujah, to see Aaron's rod swallow up the rod of the enemy and loose the glory of God in this building by the power of the Lord. Hallelujah. So I'm going to make some decrees today over this place. Job says, decree a thing, and it shall be established. And I got a mandate on me today in the Holy Ghost. Karababobo Sandai. Hallelujah. I decree that every demon spirit of sickness that's in this house has to leave today in the name of the Lord. I decree that this constricting spirit of Python that's wrapped itself around the finances of our building in the name of the Lord, you are broken in the name of Jesus. I decree, hallelujah, that depression and discouragement and unforgiveness is broken in the name of the Lord. I decree that what the enemy stole from you financially, that the enemy has to give it back seven times with interest. I decree over your ministry, over your calling, in the name of the Lord. I breathe life into it in the name of Jesus. I decree over your children that they begin to come back into the house of the Lord in the name of Jesus. I decree over your business, that it begin to prosper, that it's the head and not the tail. I decree, hallelujah, that the joy of the Lord is your strength. I speak over your marriages. I decree no divorce in this house. We decree that death is broken off of this congregation in the name of the Lord. We decree that we are a voice to the nations in the name of Jesus, and that we are the head and not the tail. Hallelujah, kaya bobobo sandaya. My God, there's something loose in this building today. There's a roar of the line of Judah trying to get up out of your spirit. Somebody needs to loose yourself in the Holy Ghost. Either we can lay in the ditch and let this serpent just just keep on constricting. Every day we get up, a little less breath, a little less joy, a little less hope, a little less quality of life. Next week it's worse. Next week it's worse. Pretty soon you can't pray anymore. The enemy clouds your mind when you try to read the Bible. You lose your desire to go to church. Seems like everybody's against you. What is that? It's unnatural. It is a snake. It is a snake that is trying to constrict you. And I'm prophesying by the Spirit of the Lord. It is a snake. Hallelujah. I see it in the Spirit. You old slant-eyed demon, I cast you out in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I decree in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Now the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Say, but if my hands are bound to my side and I am wrapped up, how do I cut his head off? Well, in the spirit, hallelujah, the sword isn't in your hand. It's in your mouth. Hallelujah. It's in your mouth. So you don't have to have any hands free. While that thing's got you wrapped up, you begin to decree, you begin to declare the word of the Lord. You begin to speak the word of God. And out of your mouth, that's what the writer said about Jesus. Out of his mouth, I saw a two-edged sword go forth. And out of your mouth, as you're being put to death by the enemy, all of a sudden, that sword goes out and begins to hack. And the enemy goes, what is that? Begins to stagger. There's a loosening. There's a loosening.
Pretty soon, that the enemy goes limp, and you just step out. And he's laying at your feet. Why do you think David cut the head off of Goliath? He already killed him. He was making a statement. This is what happens to giants that defile the Most High. And I'm declaring in the name of the Lord, this is a no snake zone. Hallelujah. I declare over your life, your life is a snow serpent zone. Hallelujah. Some of you need to get a piece of cardboard and write on it, no snake zone, and put it over the doorpost of your house. Oh, that you're declaring in the name of the Lord, hallelujah, that you're healed, that you are prosperous, that you are blessed, that you are the head and not the tail. You are the lender and not the borrower. What is it? Oh, in the name of the Lord, God, take the cloud out of their mind. It says, oh, it's just too late. It's never too late. For that same spirit that raised Christ from the dead, if it dwelleth in you, shall also quicken.
That means make alive. If we are buried with him in the likeness of his death, we are also raised with him in the likeness of his resurrection. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the atmosphere right now, there is a supernatural spirit of the Lord. Karabobobo Sunday. Hallelujah. In the name of the Lord, misunderstandings, we cast them out of this building. In the name of Jesus. Broken relationships, we cast them out of this building. In the name of Jesus. Families healed today. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Mortgages paid. In the name of Jesus. Bankruptcy cursed. In the name of the Lord. Foreclosures on homes reversed. In the name of the Lord. And mortgages paid off. In the name of Jesus. Say, that's prosperity. Well, it may be, but it's Bible. Hallelujah. I would that you prosper, even as your soul does prosper. You ready to cut the head off of the snake? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. All right, we're going to do this because prayer partners, you're going to have to cut the head off the snake too. So we're going to come together as the body of Christ. But I've heard from the Lord. And today I'm telling you in the Spirit of God that you're going to see a reversal of some things. That God is going to confirm this word with signs, wonders, following in the name of Jesus. Some of you, by the time you get home, you're going to see a change. You're going to start getting phone calls this week. Letters are going to come in the mail, says the Lord, and it's going to be the reversal of that contracting spirit that's trying to snuff you out in the name of Jesus. If you got a sword in your mouth, get out of your seat, hallelujah, and get in this altar, and I want you to think about what the enemy, the area of your life, the area of your life that you feel like that you are battling a python spirit. And I want you to hear me. It's don't pray against the individual, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but you're wrestling against spirits Hallelujah. This is why spirits are so successful. It's because people don't recognize they're dealing with spirits. They vent their energy to another person or to another thing. But God says, you have the Word of God in you. I don't know everything that you're battling. You don't know everything I'm battling. But you want to hear me. We are in the will of God. We are in the will of God. Give me the water. Harababo koshete bababa sandai. Kiaya babobo shataya bababa sandai. Kiara baba kate. Hiondoria kitaya baba babo shoto. Kiaya bababa sandai. Come on, loose your prayer language. There's something happening in the spirit right now. Yandaya bobo shataya baba kosotoria sande. Hiaria mama maka sanda. The devil has lied to some of you. The devil has lied to some of you. He's trying to suck the ruah of God out of you. Say, Pastor Ken, I have felt backslidden. I can't feel God. My prayer life is suffering. Well, in the name of the Lord, today we break that python spirit that's trying to destroy you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, we're stepping over into something. There's something coming out of your mouth. Coming out of your mouth in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Moses just didn't deliver the leaders. He delivered the old people, the children, the babies, the workers. This is a word for every single person in this building in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Some of you, the enemy says, run. Don't run. Don't run. Turn around. Pick that snake up by the tail. Cut its head off. In the name of Jesus. Cut its head off. Serve the word of the Lord. In the name of Jesus. Jackson, lead us in some worship. I want to stay in this vein right now. There's something happening in the Holy Ghost. Come on, press in. You are stepping over. We are reaching over. There is a snake that is riding right now. We are cutting this thing off. You are affecting your destiny. Cut the head of the snake off in the name of Jesus. Loose your word. Loose the word of the Lord. Loose your prayer language. Draw your sword.
In the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Your way maker, way maker, miracle work, promise keep. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, you are here, you are here. Turning lights.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's it, folks, doing something. Something happened in the spirit world.
I worship you.
Oh, yeah, come on.
Yeah.
I want us as a church today, because there's so much anointing in this building, I want us to command the spirit of Python to come off of our nation and off of this election. This has to go right. My someday, you say, well, why are we praying for the nation? You're also praying about the destiny of the church. So I want you to raise your hands, however you want to do it. Let's lift up your voice. Take the word of the Lord. Let's cut this serpent off of the United States of America. In the name of the Lord, hallelujah, we cut this python, suffocating, constricting demon that has taken our generation, taken our morality, taken our common sense, taken our joy, taken our freedoms. In the name of the Lord, we cut you off. In the name of the Lord, and we begin to declare over the United States of America that there is freedom. Hallelujah. That the Spirit of God, the army of the Lord, will begin to be loosed in this nation in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop. Come on, declare it. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, never stop. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop.
Yeah.
God. All right, here's, I believe this is what's going to happen from this service. I'm telling you, I see it in the Spirit of the Lord. Snakes are scurrying. Hallelujah. You are the blessed seed of the Lord. I bless you today in the name of Jesus. Kaya bobo shataya ba Sunday. I bless this house in the name of the Lord. I bless your coming in and your going out in Jesus' name. I bless your dreams, your desires. As difficult as it's been, we decree this is how good it's going to be in Jesus' name. So I want you to expect when you leave, you are not leaving this battle. I'm telling you, you have cut the head off this thing, and this thing is crawling off and it's going to die. We're going to end this year in victory. Hallelujah, victory. Mama Sunday. We used to sing an old song, victory, victory shall be mine. Victory, victory shall be mine. If I hold my peace and let the Lord fight the battle, victory, victory shall be mine. Hallelujah. And so I want you to leave with an expectancy. Just leave thinking, wonder what God's going to do. Wonder what's getting ready to happen. Wonder how God's going to bless us. And God is going to fulfill this word because it fell on good ground today. I want Pastor Harry to come. Close us out. I love you, and we're going to have great victory in the future.
Well, come on. Can we lift our voice? Come on. That's a rhythm. Come on. Lift your voices. Come on. Lift our voices. Come on. Lift your voice. If it's in your mouth, let it out. I said, if it's in your mouth, let it out. If it's in your mouth, let it out right now. If it's in your mouth, let it out. We declare it. We decree it. We come into agreement. Come on. We come into a total 100% agreement with this word. With this word. Say it out loud. With this word. I come into agreement in the name of Jesus. Now, one more time, lift your voice and give him glory. Come on. Thank you, Lord. Come on. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. My goodness. What a word. I said, what a word today. I don't believe, you know, personally, corporately, nationally, we believe today the word of the Lord. Amen. My goodness. My goodness. Y'all need to have an anniversary more often. Wow. What a day. What a powerful day. Whew. I got zapped down here, y'all, so I'm, thank the, my God, what, oh Lord. How many today he spoke into your life in a secret place? Come on, I'm asking, how many did he speak into your life at a secret place? Come on, I'm telling you, I love it when the Lord exposes the devil. Because he's gone once he's exposed. All right, so I'm going to, there ain't nothing left to be said. But Jesus, thank you today. Thank you today. Anointing of God that was sent here today to break every yoke and to set every captive free, to heal and deliver. We receive your work into our lives. Lord, as we leave today, we bless your name. We bless your name. And we go not as we came in. But today, we leave in a greater freedom than we've ever known before, in Jesus' name. And everybody said? So I'm going to release you, but don't forget, there is Cake Talk Podcast, Holy, Holy. Hallelujah. All right, so you got plenty of food this week. And what? And Renew class next Sunday. If you're not a member of this church, you need to be. So next Sunday, renew class, all right? So you can go in the name of the Lord. Be blessed. Turn around and bless somebody today. Just bless somebody today. Bless somebody.